Hello everyone. The topic is relining and rebasing in complete dentures from prosthodontics. What is this relining and rebasing? Now what we do is we have constructed a complete denture. And now if you see the patient, he comes back and he says that my denture, it is not retentive, like I'm eating or I'm talking. So the denture, it falls off. So in that case, instead of like reconstructing a new denture, what you do is you do the changes in that existing denture only. So you do that changes through this relining and rebasing. So relining, it is the procedure which is used to resurface the tissue side of the denture with new material layer, thus producing an accurate adaptation to the denture foundation area. Now over here, this is how relining it looks like. So in this, what you do is you just add up the material, a new layer material, and you just take a proper adaptation of it. So this is how it looks like. You are just adding up the material only on the tissue side, that is your intaglio surface, that is your impression surface. So now over here, this blue thing is like when you're adding up the material on that intaglio surface. So this is known as relining. Now it is usually carried out when the fitness of the denture, it has been deteriorated and it is not necessary to construct a new one. So if there's changes in the like denture adaptation, so if the changes are too less, and for that you don't have to construct a new one, so in that case you go for relining. Now what is rebasing? So rebasing, it is the process of replacing the entire denture base material on an existing prosthesis without changing the dental arch and the occlusal relationship. Now again, this definition is given by GPT-8. Now over here, this is the rebasing. Now in this, what you do is you replace the entire denture base material, and only this teeth, they are reserved in rebasing, whereas in relining, you're just adding up the material on this impression surface. So this is the difference between relining and rebasing. So rebasing, it is performed for the extensive tissue changes and the entire denture base, it is changed following the impression procedure. Now over here, this is your rebasing, in which you're changing, like you're replacing the entire denture base material. Now what are the indications for relining and rebasing? So the first one is if there is poor adaptation of the denture base to the ridge. Now if your denture, it is not getting adapted properly to the ridge because of the resorption of the ridge, so in that case you can go for relining. The next one is when the patient is complaining of looseness or instability of the denture following a long-standing history of comfort and satisfaction with the denture. Now if there's a patient who is wearing a denture from a very long time and he was having a good history of it, but now he's coming with the complaint of looseness or instability because now with age your ridge is going to get resorbed, so because of that he's complaining of looseness or instability of denture, so in that case you can go for relining. Then the next indication is 3 to 6 months after the construction of immediate denture. Now this immediate dentures, they are the dentures which are constructed or fabricated just after the extraction. In that case, now your sockets and your ridge, it is not properly like healed. So obviously now your ridge is going to get healed. So there will be changes which will lead to like looseness to your immediate denture. So in that case also you can go for relining, that you're just doing the changes in that immediate denture itself and you're making a good denture. The next one is for geriatric or chronically ill patient. And the next one is the patient who cannot afford the cost for the new denture. So rather than making a new denture, you're just doing the modification in the existing denture itself. Now, what are the indications for rebasing? So first one is porous or artifact if it is present on your denture base. Now, in rebasing, we have seen the definition that you're changing the or you're replacing the entire denture base material. Now, if you see that there's a void which is present in your denture base, so because of that there are chances that your denture, it will break, so in that case you have to go for rebasing. Then the next indication is loss of retention and stability, and third one is it should have correct jaw relation. Now in this, we have seen like in the definition for rebasing that we are not touching your occlusal relationship, so you have to see that when you're doing rebasing, so you should have correct jaw relation. Now, what are the contraindications, like in which cases you cannot go for relining and rebasing? So first one is if there is excessive ridge resorption. Now, if you have constructed a denture and it was like the ridge of the patient, it was comparatively good. But now with time, it is getting excessively resorbed. So in that case, you cannot go for relining and rebasing. You have to construct a new one. Then if there is presence of abused soft tissue, in that case also, you cannot go for relining or rebasing. If there is temporomandibular joint problems, if the denture, they are having poor aesthetics, so in that case now what we are doing in relining and rebasing is we're not going to touch our teeth, so in that case you cannot go for relining and rebasing if the aesthetic is of the main problem. Then if the dentures, they are having the speech problems. Because of the dentures, the patient, they complained of speech. Like, there are some speech problems. So in that case, you cannot go for relining and rebasing. You have to see what exactly the problem is and you have to construct a new one. Then if there's a presence of severe osseous undercuts, so if there are bony undercuts which are present, so in that case, you cannot go for relining and rebasing. And then if there is unsatisfactory jaw relationship in the denture. Now, we have seen in the indication that we want a very good jaw relation that has to be done, like already in the existing denture. So if there's any problem in the jaw relation only, so because of that, now the patient, they can complain of temporomandibular joint problem also if your jaw relation is not proper. So in that case also, you cannot go for relining and rebasing. What are the advantages and disadvantages of relining and rebasing? So first advantage is it eliminates the frequency of the patient visit. Now, as you are just modifying the existing denture which is present, so obviously the steps that you do in this relining and rebasing is going to reduce, and because of that, it reduces the patient's visit. The next advantage is it is economical for patient, like you are just doing the modification. So because of that, the cost of it is also less. Then it improves the fit. If there's like any problem with the fit of the denture, then it improves it. And a soft liner, it can be incorporated in the denture if it is necessary. So these are the advantages. Now, what are the disadvantages? Likelihood of altering the jaw relationship during the process. Now, we want, like we have seen in the indication, that your jaw relationship, it should be very good. And if you see that now there's a problem in this relining and rebasing. Now, what you do in rebasing is you're completely replacing the denture base material. So there are chances that you can like hamper the jaw relationship which was already done. So this is the main disadvantage, that you can alter the jaw relationship during this process. The next one is it cannot correct the aesthetics or the jaw relation. Then it cannot correct the occlusal arrangement, as we are not touching the occlusal arrangement in relining also and in rebasing also. So because of that, you cannot correct all these problems like the aesthetics, the jaw relation or the occlusal arrangement. Then the next is it cannot be used when there is excessive resorption which has occurred. Hence, it cannot be a substitute for a new denture in such cases where there is excessive resorption. So this is the disadvantage of it. Now, what are the pre-treatment procedures for this relining and rebasing? So before starting with the main procedures for relining and rebasing, you do some pre-treatment of the tissues and the denture. Now, why? Because the patient, he's already a denture wearer. So because of that, you need to prepare the tissue also, and you need to do some changes in the denture also. So what are the tissue preparations? The first is the oral mucosa. It should be free of any irritation. There should be no ulceration. There should be no irritation. So your oral mucosa and the ridge, it should be completely free of irritation. The next one is the denture. It should be left out of the mouth 2 to 3 days before making the final impression. Now, in this, you have to instruct the patient that you are not going to wear the denture for 2 to 3 days before you're coming for this relining and rebasing thing. Then the hypertrophic tissue, it should be removed. If there's an enlargement which is seen in any part of the tissue, then you have to remove that, because obviously when you do that, because this hypertrophic tissue is not going to be present always, and if you fabricate or if you do the relining and rebasing on a hypertrophic tissue, then obviously in a longer run, the patient will again come with the looseness of the denture. Then the next preparation is removal of the denture at the night and massaging of the tissue. Now you're going to again instruct the patient that you're not going to wear the denture at nights, and you're going to just massage the tissues, because now already you were wearing the dentures for a longer time. So just to soothe in that tissues, so you're just massaging that tissue. So this is like the tissue preparation that you do before starting with the main relining and rebasing. Now, what are the denture preparation? So in this, first is the border extension, it is checked and corrected. So you're going to see, like you're going to insert the denture into the patient's mouth, and you're going to see whatever the extensions are, whether it is overextended or it is understated, whatever it is, and you're going to check it, and then you're going to correct it. The next one is you're going to relieve whatever the undercuts are present. The next one is the occlusal disharmony is corrected by selective grinding. So you're going to just like, if there's an occlusal disharmony which is present, then what you're going to do is you're just going to correct it with grinding procedure. Then the pressure spots, they are adjusted. If you see if there's any pressure spots which are present in the dentures, then you're just going to adjust it properly. Then the accurate posterior palatal seal is established. And the next denture preparation is the border. It should be shortened by 1 mm to allow the space for new impression material. Now, in this procedure, in this relining and rebracing procedure, what you're going to do is, now you, again, you're going to take the secondary impression. So in this, you don't do the primary impression that we do, because now what you do is this denture, it acts as your custom tray itself. So you start with your secondary impression. So what you do is now over here with the help of your burrs, like you reduce if there's a like extension which is present in your normal denture also. So what you do is you reduce it with the help of burrs. So same way, you're just going to shorten the denture by 1 mm so that you're making a space for the bottom molding which you're going to do in the relining and rebasing. So these are the various tissue preparation things and the denture preparation procedure that you're going to do before starting the main relining and rebasing. Now, what are the main procedures for relining and rebasing? So now in this relining and rebasing, again you have the clinical procedures and the laboratory procedures. Clinical procedures are the one in which the patients are present, and laboratory procedures are the ones in which the patients are not present and you're doing them in the lab. So clinical ones, they are divided into again into two, that is indirect and direct. And indirect method, it is divided again into two, that is static and functional. And static, it is further divided into two, that is open mount technique and closed mount technique. And this direct method, it is also known as a chair side technique. Now I'm going to explain each one in detail. Now what are the various laboratory procedures? So there are three laboratory procedures, that is the articulator, jig or flask method. And the clinical procedures for relining and rebasing are similar, but the only changes you'll see are in the laboratory procedure. Now in relining, we have seen that we're just adding up the layer of material on the intaglio surface. Whereas in rebasing is, we are replacing the entire denture base material. And because of that, there are changes in this laboratory procedure, whereas your clinical procedures, they are going to be same. So starting with the first one, that is the direct method from the clinical procedure. Now this direct method, it is also known as a chair side technique. Now this is known as direct because in this you are doing the instant relining and rebasing. Now in this, the cold cure acrylic or the tissue conditioner material is used, but now they are not very durable, and as it is a direct method and because of that it is very less time consuming. Now in this, what you're going to do is the fitting surface of the denture, it is cleaned properly. You're going to roughen it with the help of sandpaper or the burrs, and then you're going to slightly reduce it. So with the help of burrs, you're reducing it. Then the flanges, they are also trimmed so that you're not like, so that you're reducing the danger of overextension. So the flanges, so your buccal, labial or the lingual flanges, they are all reduced. And if there are any undercuts which are present, then you're going to remove those undercuts. And after that, what you're going to do is you're going to apply the lubricant only on the polished surface, such that you're preventing the new material to adhere on it. Now over here on this intaglio surface, you're going to add up the new material. So now in relining, you're just adding the new material. And you're applying this lubricant. Why? Because your new material, it should not adhere on this polished surface. Now in this, the new self-curing relining material, it is then mixed properly, and then you're going to apply it on this intaglio surface. And after that, what you're going to do is you're going to insert the denture into the patient's mouth, and you're going to ask the patient to gently bite on the denture to ensure that the occlusion, it is not altered by the procedure. So after that, you're going to insert this denture, which is with that new relining material, and then you're going to insert it, and then you're going to ask the patient to bite it. And then you're going to keep the denture for 5 minutes into his mouth, and then you're going to remove it, and then you're going to carefully examine. And this is how your direct method is. Now in this, you can see like you're not going for those various laboratory procedures. So because of that, it is known as a direct method. Now what are the disadvantages of it? Now in this, there are chances that the material can be porous, and this material, it has an unpleasant odor. So this is the main disadvantage, that it is not patient compliant. Then there is excess monomer that leaches out. It can irritate the mucosa. Now as you like mix up that monomer and polymer, and in this it is a self-curing and you're just applying it directly. So you just mix it and you just apply it. So there are chances that excess monomer, it can leach out and it can irritate the mucosa. Then the exothermic heat which is produced, it can burn the mucosa. Now as we know, when your self-curing resin, it is setting, so it releases tremendous amount of heat. So because of that, it can burn the mucosa, because you're directly applying that resin into the patient's mouth. Now in this, there is poor color stability, and if it is not positioned correctly, it can lead to gross discrepancy. So these are the disadvantages of this direct method. And because of this, this direct method, it is not very commonly used, but yes, this direct method, you should know just theoretically, but practically no one does that. So the methods that we do is the indirect ones. Now, but this indirect ones I'm going to explain in the next part of this video, because now in this indirect we have seen like again they're divided into various subparts. So because of that you should know that indirect ones very well, because now you apply that indirect one clinically also. You do that indirect methods only in your clinics and even in your colleges. So because of that you should know them very well. And this was all about the first part of this relining and rebasing. I hope you found this video helpful. Thank you so much.